Hey, this is Calvin Hawkins. You're listening to the Unbelievers podcast.
There were several groups. One of the principal ones was the reptilians from the Iran complex.
Without any exaggeration, it was like being on fire inside.
Rats were eating you up inside.
This stuff was in my mouth. It felt like it was 500 degrees. It was unbelievably hot.
My first question would be, were you a member of the Church of Satan, a card-carrying member of the Church of Satan?
I don't understand.
There's always an argument for no reason. You know, just because somebody can fake something doesn't necessarily.
And we found a life form. And that's when I started shitting my pants.
So for the person who called, I am carrying an alien.
An alien baby, and we covered right here, okay?
Okay.
Something is happening. What is it? That's the question. So do UFOs exist? It depends on what you mean, exist.
Alien contactees, regular boring people whose lives were forever changed after having direct communication with extraterrestrial beings. Many of these contactees have reached ET by using such techniques as CE5 meditation, flashlight signaling, and fishing. Names like George Adamski, Billy Meyer, and Stephen Greer purport to have a special relationship with the space people or to share their galactic message with humanity for a price. Thankfully, there are other alien contactees, ones who have not sought public attention or monetary gain, yet still produce some of the most compelling and confounding UFO and alien images that many experts find hard to explain. So join us now as we discuss Vancouver, Canada's most interesting person and the sweetest lady to ever film aliens with an 8mm camera. It's time for Dorothy Izatt, Alien Contactee. Right here on the program, we continue to learn to unlearn
everything you know.
Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm your host, Russ Ryan. And joining me as always is my co-host, Drea Mora. Hello, Drea.
Hello.
And our soundboard engineer and producer, Rob Oakey.
It's almost like it sucks something.
What's up, guys?
Hello, Rob. Hello, hey. Drea. And I've got a little something different off the top here. I actually have an announcement, some Unbeliever news.
Ooh.
Or actually some unbelievable news. I got some news about the Unbelievable podcast. If you were a fan who noticed that the Unbelievable podcast archives had been missing off of Spreaker, I've got good news. There is a new RSS feed set up now. We reached out to Brian about it. A lot of people were asking, and there's a new RSS feed up. It's almost like the Art Bell archives now. You just send us a message, and we can send you a link to all the archives. So all the old Unbelievable podcasts are back again.
Yes, thank God. Thank God, because what would we do without those? That would just
There's
be like
a lot of really good ones.
A living
like the first
honestly,
100.
Yeah.
I still go back and re-listen, especially on long car drives. It's perfect.
They're great. And yeah, they're available again. So yeah, much like Art Bell, Brian is now in the archive. So hit us up. Well, you know, if you're a fan, and we'll get you a link. But we got our own stuff to do tonight. We got to work on our own archives. Maybe we'll hide all these one day. Because tonight we are talking alien contactee Dorothy Izatt. The mystery lights, the traces. That's a little bit relevant to what we're talking tonight, because tonight we'll be discussing the fascinating story of a woman named Dorothy Izatt, alien contactee. Born Dorothy Wilkins on September 24th, 1922 in Kowloon, Hong Kong, she went on to marry a man named Duncan Izatt and started a family with him in Vancouver, Canada. Dorothy lived a very normal life and had no particular interest in UFOs, in aliens, until 1974, when she filmed A Strange Light in the Skies Over Vancouver. And here is more about that from an appearance that Dorothy Izatt made on Unsolved Mysteries in 1990. 2 weeks in a row, guys, back-to-back stack action.
Yeah. Whoa.
Double stack.
Let's get it going.
The double stack, but now with it's in a Canadian mystery also. Let's hear.
Vancouver, British Columbia, on the Pacific coast of Canada. For 35 years, this city has reported an inordinate number of UFO sightings. The most frequent and well-documented of the sightings have all been attributed to one woman, Dorothy Izatt, a homemaker and mother of four. Dorothy's first sighting occurred 16 years ago on November 9th, 1974. She was 52 years old.
I was in the kitchen fixing myself a cup of tea, and I had a sensation that something was watching me. Very, very strong feeling. So I went over to the window, and here was this enormous object sitting up in the sky. It looked like an enormous diamond. It was just flashing, going around and around and around. It was so beautiful to look at that I felt I was really lifted up. It was absolutely a wonderful feeling. I wasn't afraid at all, you know. I felt really privileged to be able to see something like that.
This is Dorothy Izatt, a woman who has an amazing UFO experience at age 52. It's never too late, guys, to become almost famous in the UFO world. 52.
That's good. I'll have to look forward to that.
What a story, though. What a freaking story. It's actually very interesting that they covered this on Unsolved Mysteries, because when I was watching the thing we're going to talk about later, I kind of had a feeling I had seen this before, and this is starting to make sense now.
I like that she is responsible for the majority of the sightings in this region. They're like, yeah, we get a lot of sightings here. About 90% are just from Dorothy's house, but still a lot of sightings.
Yeah, it's like it's one of those things where you don't necessarily want to be called the, like, oh, that's that UFO lady again. It's got more stories and stuff. But at the same time, it's like, you know, if it keeps happening and you keep documenting it, it's like showing, I don't know, conviction that she's like, no, this is definitely real.
It did sound like this was going to be a regional based thing, though, when they first started talking about it in the beginning. But then, no, it's about Dorothy. Who would have thought?
Yeah, and Dorothy's husband and family, they were skeptical of her alleged UFO sightings, saying to her, it's probably a star or an airplane. So Dorothy set out to prove that it was real and rub it in their faces.
I said, I must find some way of communicating with this thing up there. So I picked up a flashlight and said, all right, whatever I do with this flashlight, would you please imitate me? So I flashed the light three times to the left, and this object went three times to the left. Then I flashed it three times to the right, and the object went three times to the right. Then I went three times upwards, it went three times upwards, three times downwards, it went three times downwards. It was doing everything and then zigzagging, and it went zigzag. So I said, I'm not imagining this. I said, this is really happening. So it's intelligent.
Dorothy was amazed that the light seemed to be trying to communicate with her. So she attempted to capture them on film. The results would be startling.
You know, there is something to people blinking flashlights at UFOs in the 70s. Greer did it, the Allagash 4, now Dorothy Izatt, and it works every time.
That's my first instinct. If I see some kind of light and I'm thinking, you know, you try to signal, what else are you going to use, a lighter?
Well, we know what that is, guys. That's CE5 technique.
It
right
is.
There.
It okay? is. And it totally is.
Not only is it CE5 technique, that's Christo Rapolo technique. Let's take it even back. Let's take it way back. That's how Christo does this shit, too. So, I don't know. There's something to it, man. There's something to that whole, like signaling with the flashlight thing. I love how it always turns into like a wedding dance where it's like to the left twice.
I hate that.
Zigzag and then a side to side with her.
I'm glad you brought it up early though. She's totally the Canadian version of Christo, because the whole like regional thing, and then she just keeps on with it, is making sure she's documenting it.
Oh, yeah. She documents it, yeah. And after establishing communication via flashlight, Dorothy filmed the responding lights, and some of the footage is remarkable.
What I saw in the sky was just round objects of light, round balls of light. But what was on the film, you'll see the balls of light, but after a couple of frames, there'll be this enormous blast of light.
On her home viewer, Dorothy inched the film back and forth until she isolated a single bright frame. What had at first appeared to be a simple flash of light was actually a maze of colored streaks. Oddly, the light did not spill over onto adjacent frames.
I noticed that while I'm filming these objects, they'll suddenly stop, and then I'll notice one object shooting out a little beam at the other object, and that object will be shooting out a little beam back at it, and sort of, I guess it must be messages or something that they're passing back and forth on these beams of light. And then when I get it developed, I'll find all these strange one-frame shots on it.
Yeah, the UFOs zapping each other. They are UFO zappers. And I love this footage because they got these balls of light. They're flying around. They're zapping. But she has these giant flashes of light that occur when she's filming, almost like a lightning flash.
But when you take that still frame of that moment, Drea, there's so much happening in those images.
Yeah, it's crazy. And it reminded me of some of the photo stills that we saw in the Greer documentary. And so when I saw these ones and how similar they were, I kind of felt like I should take back some of what I said about the ones from the CE5 things, where I was like, yeah, but some of those could have been, you know, reflected off of zippers or whatever. They're so similar to these, though.
The difference, though, is that most of those things that we saw in the Stephen Greer documentary are like long exposure.
Oh, yeah, so yeah, true.
That's why, like, you can see the trails and all that. She's not doing anything to create
this. Yeah, it's just within
effect.
1 second.
This is like some sort of like a photographic anomaly that she is able to somehow make happen by filming these things.
It's in her images when there is this big flash of light and she, you know, she takes a still frame of it. There's like these ropes of light everywhere and it looks like an old trapper keeper design or like almost like a good rod tape.
Yeah, I had a feeling you were going to bring up the rods.
Sky News 9 in 1999.
Those rods are huge, man.
It's like a Rod Rave, her thing. It's like neon lights, all these different colors. But just for this 1 second, one frame of her image where there was just this one little dot flying around. And then, yeah, it looks like some electric city.
It almost looks like if someone shakes the camera or something really quick. Like that's the sort of effect that it kind of creates, because all the dots, you know, they look like they're going all over the place, but it's hard to tell really what's happening. Like she describes it as she thinks that they're communicating with each other, which I think is interesting. It kind of does harken back to the Stephen Greer thing too, of how he talked about how they're just not on this dimension and they can phase between dimensions.
Exactly.
And certain times you're able to see certain things and other times you're not able to see certain things because of their interdimensional shifting that they do. So maybe she's capturing that on film.
She's
somehow.
Better. Yeah. She's better, like George and Ori say. You're better. She's better. I like her better.
It's just like they're in it. Like, yeah, we don't understand how fast they can really move. It's like faster than the speed of light, you know?
Yeah. And we didn't really talk about how sweet of a woman she really is. Like, this lady, I think they mentioned in the beginning that she wasn't like a UFO person. She wasn't big into this stuff. She's not like an alien, you know, like a huge
obsessed
fan
person,
of
yeah, I think,
like
no.
giant sci fi fan or anything like that. She's just a nice older lady.
Very nice older lady, and these lights, they seem to obey her commands. She can even get them to come closer for some better shots.
Sometimes they'll beam a light down at me. They'll just beam this enormous light down at me, you know, and I'll be all lit up with this light. I used to ask them to come closer and closer because I wanted better shots, and they did, you know, like come closer and closer.
I don't think she's lying about what she's doing. I feel that she's quite sincere. On the other hand, I'm not able to assess her her photographs professionally because that's not part of my expertise. But her personality makeup would make me believe that she's not making things up.
Okay, that was Dr. Doofy Durr, a psychologist from from the university.
Dr. Doofy Durr, is that what you just called
him? Oh my goodness, his mom
Dr.
didn't like him.
Dr. Doofy Durr, he's a psychologist from the University of British Columbia, go Thunderbirds. And he finds Dorothy to be a credible witness, but as you heard him say, he's a psychologist and he's not qualified to analyze UFO films. Like, okay, fair enough, Mr. Durr. Dr. Durr, sorry.
Dr. Durr, sorry.
Dr. Durr.
I can't. Durr Pepper. Dr.
Oh, Durr. Like you're saying, Chip, a lot of this, the reason that a lot of people give her credit is, like Rob said, this is a very, very sweet woman and she seems like the most credible person you could ever meet. And she definitely impressed Dr. Durr Durr.
You heard her talking about that beam, too, right? You know, she reminded me a little bit when she started talking about the beam. Remember this?
I've always wanted to be abducted by a UFO.
I didn't even think about that. When she mentioned just, like, beams and they're beaming each other, beams, I was just thinking beans. Like, oh, my God, her tapes are full of beans.
Oh, she's saying her tapes are full of beans?
You're saying her tapes are full of beans?
Yeah, but my mother thought I was full of beans. So.
Beams.
Yeah, her tapes are full of beams.
Well, Dr. Doofy Durr might not have been qualified to analyze that, but someone who was is a man named Vern Miller. This is a photo expert from the Brooks Institute who has this to say about Dorothy's light ball footage.
I have seen several similar examples of photography like this. Light sources in the sky with dark backgrounds are quite easy to manipulate, but these are more extraordinary in the sense that they were done with an 8mm camera, a motion picture camera, rather than a still camera, and they have so many different types of effects. There's images that I can't explain at all. explain how the lights got into the individual frames. I can suggest ways that they could have been put in intentionally, but no ways that they could accidentally have been placed into the film. I believe that these images were produced by natural occurring phenomenon in the night sky and not by extraterrestrial beings or unexplained objects.
I liked him till the end there. He sounded like he was about to back Dorothy with a good scientific explanation, but no, natural lights, Vern says.
Yeah, which is bullshit because she'd have to be doing that consistently for all of these hundreds of cases.
And that doesn't explain that whole anomaly that happens where one of the frames has a, you know, the strange difference from all of the other frames. The frame before and after it don't have it. So how are you? Yeah. How is that naturally occurring in the atmosphere?
Exactly. Unsolved Mysteries has to have a skeptic, guys. That's have to.
That is true.
And this is one of the least harsh ones you can get, Vern Miller. You want to pull him in the skeptic pool.
Yeah. If you're, like you said, on here. Almost sounded like he was on our side for a second.
He's close.
I will say, I appreciate people being very objective like that and just stating things completely as they are without like any heavy lean one way or another. So
yeah,
he's all right in my book.
Yeah, he's not that bad. But despite the skeptics like Vern, Dorothy Izatt gained a lot of popularity in the UFO community, and as her fame spread, people would come to Vancouver just to visit her and hopefully see the lights for themselves. And one of those visitors was a guy named Jerry Mackay, who read an article about Dorothy and felt compelled to meet her.
I was interested enough and moved enough by that article that I really did just want to find out more for my own interest's sake. I think it's healthy to be skeptical, because I was myself. I didn't have any previous experience with the subject matter at all. I didn't even realize up until that point that I had as much of an interest with it as it's turned out that I do. I was listening very intently to what she was saying, at which time I noticed that I was hearing some kind of audible sensing thing that was happening only in my right ear. Excuse me, Dorothy, I don't mean to interrupt you, but I'm getting a strange sensation in my ear here. So I'm sort of losing what you're saying.
You can hear that?
And I looked at her and I said, yes, I can. What is it? And this brilliant beam of smile went from ear to ear on her face. And I remember the look that she gave me. And she said, they're here.
Man, I'm jealous of this Jerry guy. I want to have an experience with Dorothy. I want to have a smile beam at me.
More beams. No, yeah.
This guy
great.
Was a skeptic. He was a skeptic going in. But Dorothy is undeniable.
She's so earnest in how she presents everything. And like, she checks all of those boxes that we usually look at for credibility, you know, doesn't seek out fame, doesn't want anyone, has not been compensated, doesn't seek it. And she's
Let
just
guys
so
who read
humble.
About her in magazines just come over anytime they want. And
she
then
just
they,
wants to give you tea and stuff. She's like, she's just a sweet lady. And yeah, it's not like she's trying to win you over with that personality trait. She just is. And she's like, well, you know, if you believe it, then cool. If not, oh well.
There is something a little dark about her, like smiling and saying, they're here. I don't know what that reminds me of. Maybe the poltergeist or something.
Maybe
like
a little
that.
Bit.
Maybe something along those lines. Like the creepy little
kid. Way to
make
it
kid.
Dark.
Yeah, that's,
yeah, but she's not a creepy little kid. She's like, she's a genuinely nice lady. She smiled from ear to ear and you just made it sad and, well, and dark.
Because Unsolved Mysteries in their sound effect work made it spooky. Vacant,
oh, yeah.
She
okay.
said they're
All
here.
Right.
They
we'll
hit the
Rob
dramatic
the
note.
Right.
Listen, anytime anybody says they're here, I think about the poltergeist anyway. So if...
Even if it's like a surprise party and you're just supposed to hide and wait for the... Like, okay, they're here. Surprise. You're like, no, okay. It's the poltergeist.
In that one situation, that one instance right there, I don't. But most other situations when people say they're here makes me think of the poltergeist. The way she just did it was very dramatic.
Steven
very
Spielberg.
Much, yes.
Between E.T. and poltergeist, man, Spielberg's just like kind of gotten in your head real good.
Dinosaurs.
Let's hear more about Jerry's big day with Miss Izatt.
Jerry Mackay was the first person to say he actually heard the same thing that Dorothy heard.
I don't think any more than 15 or 20 seconds went by, and she said, do you see it?
Do you see it, Jerry?
No, I don't see anything.
Where are you looking?
I'm looking straight ahead across the Cypress Bowl. She goes, no, look over here to the left where I am. To my complete shock and amazement, what appeared to be sitting right out in front of the window just to our left was a hard metallic object. I remember the feeling was so intense, it was like I was standing in a vacuum and all my hair was standing on end. And as soon as it disappeared, Dorothy let out a giggle that was like, there you go. What do you think of that?
Yeah, what do you think of that? It seems like they're both getting confirmation. Dorothy almost sounds surprised that another person gets to experience this. She lets out a giggle.
I mean, what are you going to do? You know, nobody believes you all these years, and you get to watch somebody believe you in that instant. I'd probably start laughing my ass off. Yeah. I don't know.
It was the first time she ever met anybody else who had that spidey sense that she's got, where she can just sense that the UFOs are coming. So that's why, you know, this is like a special thing for her, I feel like. It's like, I'm not alone in this right now.
And Jerry, poor Jerry, he was so overwhelmed by this that it didn't occur to him to take any photos or videos. Maybe next time, Jerry, if there is another one. But at this point, in 1991, Dorothy, she's taken over 25 hours of film and had over 3,000 blow-ups made of some of the more stunning frames. They even call the still frames blow-ups in this. That's a throwback. And here she is talking about what her goals are for collecting this footage.
I feel there is some sort of message in there for us. They're trying to tell us something from these pictures. It seems like they're coming closer and closer all the time compared to the first pictures I used to take. And each picture now that I'm getting is far more vivid. It varies all the time. My mission is to just keep filming, I guess, and receiving these pictures for as long as I am able to, and hope that one day someone or somewhere will be able to understand what it's all about.
Man, it's got to be frustrating having these encounters, knowing that there's a message from beyond the stars or from another dimension, but you're not able to do anything with it. That you get everything in, but you can't process it.
I know. I mean, I would be wondering, too. Like, they seem benevolent enough, but, like, after a while, it's like, does she just keep getting excited, as excited each time, or should you get like bored of them?
Well, it's funny you said that, Russ, because I never even thought about it really like that, to be honest. Because just because her temperament and the way that she deals with it, she doesn't ever come off like she's looking for an answer. Like, she's just like willing and open to the experience. And every time it happens, she's just like approaches it with that same kind of openness where she's just like, let's just see what this is. And it's interesting the way that you put it, though, that like it is like she's being given this message constantly, but there's no way to decipher what the message is or what it means or anything.
Yeah. Like, what is like what are you trying to tell me? You know, like, get to it.
But I'm just saying, I like that she doesn't really need an answer. It doesn't seem like she needs an answer.
It's a mystery. And usually Unsolved Mysteries tells us that you, too, might help solve a mystery. But this time, they try to solve it themselves.
When Unsolved Mysteries visited Dorothy Izatt's home in Vancouver, she told us the lights were there, and she filmed them with her Super 8mm camera. We could not see the lights, but our cameraman attempted to film them anyway. He also asked Dorothy to operate his camera. The film from Dorothy's 8mm camera showed the usual brilliant light patterns. When we developed our film, we did find one tiny, unidentifiable light in the sky, but it exhibited none of the characteristics seen in Dorothy's photographs.
Mm. Not a straight-up debunking. So the mystery remains. That is one of those ones.
And it's spooky again.
Like, why is this on Unsolved Mystery? I don't think anyone at home is going to figure it out.
I mean, I don't know.
It's unsolved.
That's unsolved, and it's a mystery. So honestly, it fits perfectly into what they're looking for, I think, for these sort of things. But, I don't know how to.
They almost went
that.
Monster Quest. They went Monster Quest. Like, we're going to analyze this. Like, that's not your job on Unsolved Mysteries. You don't send your camera crews looking for the rapist or anything.
It's like, whoa. I don't want this mystery being solved. This has to remain unsolved.
Sets a bad precedent for the rest of the show going forward. It's like, why didn't you guys do anything?
It is interesting, though, that their camera didn't capture anything because.
They got a small one. Got a little one.
But I feel like that was probably just like.
She was probably nothing.
It was probably like a helicopter really far away or something. But like, I think that might have something to do with it, where it's like, this is a very metaphysical and like spiritual thing where like, if you go into this experience and are trying to disprove it or like bring negative energy to it, you may not be granted the ability to witness it and be part of it. And
so it becomes like a self-fulfilling prophecy. People who are like, this isn't real, they'll never be able to see it, and they will forever be unconvinced.
Kind of, like the shows.
That's frustrating.
Like a lot of the shows we talk about are like the Rob Lowe show, where he's like, you know what, I'm going to go solve everything. But he doesn't do the work beforehand to understand it. So that was her appearance on Unsolved Mysteries, but her popularity grew more in the 1990s, and her footage became even more remarkable. So remarkable that in 1998, she was featured on the news magazine program Hard Copy.
Watch very closely, because if this video is what it's purported to be, you're looking at an alien in a spaceship.
You can clearly see figures in the window, and you know, they turn their heads.
Already studied and authenticated by some photo experts, it's just one of thousands of dazzling images from what's been hailed as the greatest UFO story ever told. It's an extraterrestrial mystery that's confounded everyone, from psychiatrists to scientists and respected UFO investigators.
It's an authentic phenomenon. Something real is going on, but they have absolutely no idea as to what it is.
Yes, aliens are in the film now. That is the big news. And this is a reputable news source. And even they say this is undebunkable. But guess what? I'm sold, because this is hard copy. This was hard news back in the 90s. So you have to believe it.
The harder, the better. That's more believable. Coming from more than one TV show, too. You know, it's not just like, oh, that TV show is always full of beans. Like,
so it's about 7 years later. Her footage had kind of, you know, gotten a little more extraordinary. We got to hear more. Let's hear more about...
Wait, did she say she was seeing aliens moving around inside of the spaceships now? What?
There are aliens inside the ship. Yes, place on board one.
You're looking at an alien in a spaceship.
One of the images is a couple of aliens. It looks like they're kind of peeking out of their ship at her in one of these pictures. And let's hear more hard news about the lovable Dorothy.
Her name is Dorothy Izatt, the world's most unlikely UFO contactee. A 75-year-old great-grandmother who says she's been communicating with visitors from other worlds for 25 years. These pictures are the result, showing everything from alien beings to spaceships to masses of glowing orbs in the sky and inexplicable flashes of light. All contained on more than 350 reels of film, this spry granny shot with her little Super 8 camera from the balcony of her Vancouver apartment.
Call her a spry granny. Come on.
Oh, she's a spry granny. That's a compliment. She's a very cool granny. I wish she was my grandma.
Yeah, no, she is really sweet. Look, I didn't really get to have much of a relationship with my grandparents. I don't have any now. But so, like, yeah, I would love for her to be my grandma. She's like when you think of a nice old lady and a granny.
I mean, play with her Super 8 camera at the house and stuff like that.
I guess it's the phrase of the spry granny. It's like, just imagine her, like, crouching around and, like, jumping, like, doing parkour.
I just felt like that was a little bit, like, snarky. It was just, like, a little bit of a tone to it. I don't know. It's like, this is
granny. Because
granny
doesn't have the respect on,
like,
the name.
Let's be nice.
She's hopping around getting alien footage for people. She's not resting. She's got Super 8 cameras everywhere.
She's very sweet. It's a very sweet grandma, this lady.
And there's a reason that Dorothy's story gained this new attention from these major news sources, like Hard Copy. It's because of Play Soundboard 2.
Aliens.
Exactly. Play clip 12.
This is without a doubt the most remarkable piece of footage she shot.
It was where the aliens showed up.
It's an image that appeared during one of Dorothy's routine sky watches just recently.
And then I noticed that in a window were a couple of aliens in a window. So I said, oh dear, I can't see it. The light's so bright. I said, I need to film you. I said, can you turn the lights off the ship? And I can film you. And they did. The lights go off. The aliens are there.
And believe it or not, like all of Dorothy's footage, this has been scientifically tested and declared genuine, or at least not faked.
There's not a lot that we know about it, but we know that it's real.
Yeah, boom. No one is able to refute these besides that one guy from before. And now she's got pictures of aliens waving from inside the spaceship.
I wish I would have seen that.
Can you turn the lights down on the ship so I can get a better shot? Because you guys are just totally blown out right now.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Dorothy. Yeah, here you go.
The newsman wasn't exaggerating. This might be the greatest UFO story ever told. I don't think that was just hyperbole at the beginning. And did you guys recognize that soundboard clip that aliens want to play before? Yeah. Play soundboard 3. I think this will jog some people's memory. Because immediately after that,
The rod, I think it's like a walking stick.
Famous
Chewbacca. Can you believe I got that close to a rod?
Yes.
Have you ever seen Chewbacca?
Kid. Of course, this one.
I can't believe I was that close to a rod. Have you ever seen a Chewbacca?
Now I remember. Yeah, now I remember.
Now we got more of this kid. We got the aliens. We got the and the new one. Place over three again.
The rod. I think it's like a walking stick.
Okay. You shoehorned that one in there though. That one, you know what I mean? Like there was no trigger for that one. You just kind
of.
You snuck I just want to hear it all there. The time anyway, so I'm all right with it.
All right, then back to the story. Here it's wrapping up, and we learn what Dorothy believes the aliens are.
There is a spiritual world, and there is a non-spiritual world, a material world, and so forth. What Dorothy has done is she's bridged the gulf between the two.
Meanwhile, Dorothy simply calls her ET friends life beings, who she says come from diverse parts of the universe to impart a simple message to mankind.
No one wants to listen to it because it's so simple and it's so easy. It's L-O-V-E, just love.
Yeah, the light beings. They're light beings. I think he said life beings. And man, she got so close. She almost said it's so silly, so ridiculous. It just might work. But I like hers a little better. Play soundboard 4.
It's so simple and it's so easy. It's L-O-V-E. Just love.
Aww.
Right. L-O-V-E.
Well, yeah. Love is like pretty simple and ridiculous. And
that's
silly.
Like the Fab Four taught us. Yeah, that's not so
such a sweet old hippie lady. I love her so much.
Yeah, she really is remarkable. Dorothy Izatt's amazing contact with these light beings of love was examined even further in a 2008 documentary titled Capturing the Light, directed by Frank Longo. Mm. And it featured a man named Peter Gotilla, who wrote a book about her, about Dorothy, called Contact with Beings of Light, The Amazing True Story of Dorothy Wilkinson Izatt. Mm-hmm. And Drea and Rob, you guys watched this documentary, correct?
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
And
good. Yeah, and I'll say right now,
yes,
I watched two films in the past 24 hours, and one of them was a lot better than the other one. One of them was Space Jam 2, and the other one was Catching the Light, and Catching the Light was amazingly 10 million times better than Space Jam 2. So if you're thinking about watching Space Jam 2 this week, Catching the Light instead.
It's capturing. We're not catching it.
Watch Capturing the Light
Just
instead.
Think about Bugs Bunny while you're watching it. It'll be fine.
Well, here is the man who wrote the book on her, Peter Gotilla. This is what he has to say about Dorothy.
What I had set out to do was to either validate or invalidate Dorothy Wilkinson Izatt. To my own satisfaction, you won't find a stain anywhere. All of my investigation, all of my questioning and interrogating, all of my interviews directly with Mrs. Izatt and with those who have known her led me to believe that she was completely trustworthy. An ordinary person, raised a family, lived a good life, very decent, no fooling around, no chicanery, nothing. And I knew at once that I had an honest person. I had known many contactees, as they're called. These are people who claim ongoing encounters with non-terrestrial beings. I'd known many. I'd never been able to endorse one of them.
Yes, until Dorothy and the light beings. That is a glowing endorsement from what sounds like a harsh critic of the alien contactee phenomena.
Yeah, and it just goes to show that, I mean, I don't know why I haven't heard of her story before, because if it's like no one's been able to debunk it so far, and it's convincing all of these skeptics.
Like, I'll bet you we know more about the ones that he doesn't believe. We've probably talked about him before.
Probably.
The ones that Peter could tell, these alien contactees, and maybe that's why. Maybe it's not as... I think her story is really eye-opening. The images themselves are great.
It is. It was really like... I was getting chills, but like in a good way. Like it's creepy when you think about just like, oh my God, this stuff is, you know, real. But I mean, just seeing how happy it makes her, and she's like all content, and you know, she's a church-going lady and everything, and there's nothing dark or evil about these things. It's like, okay, it's exciting.
I mean, what is he talking about, though, guys? Like, are there alien abductees lying about this stuff? Is there actually people that are faking this stuff out there?
Are there people who really go out there and lie about
stuff? Is that possible? Would people lie about something like this?
Why would they lie?
Would they cause such chicanery?
Yeah, the chicanery. That's an indictment right there. And But since Miss Izatt is such an incredible contactee to Gotilla, He focuses on examining her footage, particularly those frames that were taken from the giant bursts of light.
The ones that occur in a single frame usually occur in a burst of light. If you're running the film in a projector and you're looking at the screen, all you're going to see is a bang. Slow the film down and examine that frame. You'll see squiggles of light. Many times these are multicolored, reds, greens, whites, yellows, and so forth. Other times you will see creatures that look quite human in the sense that they are as if she's somehow taking images from the past or the future. They look quite earthlike. And landscapes, other dimensions, the past, the future, who knows? Mrs. Izatt is presenting us with an entirely different view of UFOs, extraterrestrial visitation, and what it means to mankind.
There's so much going on in these. There's light zapping around. You got aliens waving at you, the past, the future, dimensions. It's like Loki.
It is. You know what? I was actually thinking the same thing watching this. I was like, this is reminding me of Loki for some reason. Because it's just the way that they describe it. It's insane, actually.
Yeah, and there's been a lot of respected film industry types that have come to Dorothy's defense, which I found surprising, and including Hollywood production designer Steve Giegum, who was brought in 1988 to dissect Dorothy's 8mm footage.
As the years have passed, our capabilities in the industry of duplicating what Dorothy does have increased. The problem is that the volume of Dorothy's work is so massive that even a group of very skilled people in our industry would take a tremendous amount of time to do it, and it would cost a tremendous amount of money. The process is extremely complicated to get from a visual effects image on a computer and then telecine it down to 8mm. It's not done. 8mm is not the kind of film that we use professionally. I can look at her work over the last 15 years that I've been involved with her and say pretty unequivocally that she's not cooking this up in a basement lab.
Yeah, even Hollywood can't duplicate it. And as much as I want to believe, and in a lot of ways I do believe, I think it would be funny if it turned out she was cooking it up in a basement and scamming people. It's like the sweet old lady just playing everyone. I don't believe that. I just think it would be funny.
Yeah, it would be. That's like the least likely source of it, but that's how you get away with stuff. Yeah, I don't know. When they were talking about cooking it up in a basement, I was just thinking of drugs.
Yeah, she's not Walter White in the basement cooking up like some.
It's not paranormal, White. No. She's not chopping up 8mm film to put little shots of light in there.
No,
because, and totally not making any money off of it.
Because even Hollywood people can't even duplicate it. They've tried, even with CG. I mean, she's recording 1970s and 80s with an 8mm camera. I don't think you can do the things that she did, you know, well, the images that
she the way the guy describes it, he says that it's, like, impossible to transfer the footage from anything onto that. It's, like, virtually impossible to do. Or if it is done, it's done very technically and something that she probably wouldn't be able to do.
No, like, even if she knew how to, it's like for those people to be unable to duplicate it themselves and they're like the experts in the industry, that's pretty telling.
Yeah, she really could pull a fast one if she wanted to. And it might not be that hard for her to do that, but this next clip is just another example of how much everyone loves this woman.
The most compelling reason to believe that this footage is real is her. She's a nice older grandmother sort, and there are 30,000 feet of film with this. She has no reason to do this that we know of. She seems mentally stable. She seems like an intelligent woman. She hasn't profited from this. It seems like she doesn't like media exposure that much, and the family doesn't like media exposure that much. That's the most compelling reason to believe that this footage is real.
Those are really good reasons. Not profiting is a big one. And I gotta say, also the fact that she hasn't tried to start a religion is a good one too, because with what she's got going, you know, with the physical evidence and just her own mindset and thinking, you could easily start a cult with this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's like that's that checklist I was talking about, the guy rattling off all those different factors about what makes her so credible.
Sweet old granny, like, is always number one. Like, she's number, okay, number one, really sweet grandma. Number two, the most amazing UFO footage. Number three, no basement.
You're right. The first one is always just like, it's like, just look at her. Come on.
Come on.
It's like, she would never. She's the sweetest old lady.
Look at that mouth.
Yeah, just look. No, whoa. Let's take
it. No, look at the mouth smile is beaming at you.
I'm totally on board now, guys. I'm totally on board. Oh, wait.
Look at that mouth.
All right. Then guess what? Now. I'm sold. You got it. All right. Dorothy talks about how she first became known in UFO circles when she spoke with famed radio host Pat Burns, who got her in contact with the granddaddy of the UFO movement, J. Allen Hynekin, as Calvin Parker likes to call him. And Mr. Hynekin gave her some really, really good advice.
So Professor Heine advised me to get more cameras and experiment with it. And they asked me to film with three cameras, and I used to do that. I have to keep three there with me all the time, and you just pick one up, drop it on the floor, pick another one, drop it, and pick another. When we got back all the films and everything, they put it together, and I had the same object on all three of them. He suggested to get someone to do all the tests they can with me. They came back that he said, you're better than average, you know, with all the answers that you gave us.
When Dr. Hynek investigated Dorothy Izatt, he came away convinced that she was genuine, that her films were genuine.
And on the advice of Professor Hynek, he said, you be very careful, you know, the people you deal with. Most of all, he said, keep away from the lunatic fringe. He said, because don't forget, he said, you'll be tired with the same brush. He said, gather all the information you can until you have enough and you're ready, then you go out, he said, and let people know what you have. But you have to have all the proof, you have to have everything there ready for anyone that wants to tear you down. And I took his advice and disappeared like God. That's why a lot of people say, oh, didn't hear from me, didn't see me. It's because I took his advice and stayed away.
You know, people have a lot of mixed feelings about Hynek, but that is solid advice he gave her there. And that kind of answers your question, Dre, of why, you know, she wasn't so much on the radar of the UFO community. Because she followed the advice, she documents the evidence, she stays away from the kooks and the nuts, she stays honest, and she kind of stays in her own thing. And play Soundboard 5, because the best advice is...
Most of all, he said, keep away from the lunatic fringe.
Yes, the lunatic fringe, which is a lot of times roped into the alien contactee, and maybe the channeling movement as well. I think all that was adjacent around these times, 70s, 80s, 90s. Yeah, stay away from the lunatic fringe.
I thought you said the lunatic French at first. I was like, that's a little harsh. I mean, French are the French, but let's not call them lunatics.
Dre, he wasn't talking about Dean Ambrose either.
Oh, darn.
I know you got a little wrestling
No, that's a good thing. Then you don't have to stay away from him.
Yeah, you can go to your AEW events. You can hang out with him. All right. Yeah, that's great advice if you're watching wrestling. Play Soundboard 5.
Most of all, he said, keep away from the lunatic fringe.
That's right.
Don't hurt you.
So by 2008, Dorothy had been experiencing this contact for 34 years. And in that time, she developed a good understanding of the nature of these light beings.
They come through interdimensionally. I call them the light beams because they come in light. When you see the bright lights of my film, they're just the lead of what is to come. Little probes of light let me know that they're preparing something. So I have to aim my camera and keep it on a little scout till there'll be a blast of light. When the film is processed, I get a lot of surprises. They show me things. The whole craft is huge, but you can't see that because it's in darkness. And if they want you to see them, they all appear either on a small little window and looking out the windows. It's nothing to do just with UFOs. The lights on my film are the same lights that's been showered down all the time on us from the Creator himself. It's because of this light that it gives us knowledge, this feeling inside it, that we're all born with, who we were before we even took on an earthly form. We are all beings of light.
Yeah, we're all light beings. And what she's seeing, these are our light friends showing us lights, right?
Yeah.
And I could be a light being. I could do that. Are you guys cool being light beings?
I mean, I like the idea of it, but it's like, how can we have to be told and explained how to be light if we are?
Maybe she is just a little slow in the afterlife. I don't know. Maybe we all get it. And that's why they have to kind of spell it out to her over a few decades.
I think she's leaning more in the direction of like, it's feeling more like a religious experience now where this is like they're angels or something.
It's very personal for her.
Like.
And she's a very spiritual, religious person. She mentions being Catholic in this, and maybe it does play in, but I don't see her pushing that on anyone. Like I said, maybe no. She's not starting her own UFO religion. Which,
yeah, I don't think she's pushing it on anyone, and it doesn't come, like, it almost feels like the setup for, like, a cultish sort of a thing, like you were talking about. Like, this is usually how they, like...
Heaven's Gate.
Yeah, this is, like, how they get the ball rolling, and then it turns into a cult. There's always, like, a figure like this who's,
yeah, they make you try to buy an app.
At the top of it, and then things start to get weird down the road, but it doesn't really seem like she's not really like that.
She's the other side of the coin of Jay-Z Knight. Jay-Z Knight, who went down the road of starting an alien channeling cult, making people do all kind of weird stuff in labyrinths, allegedly. I don't really know.
Yeah, because here's the difference, too. The biggest difference is when she's seeing these otherworldly things, she's not saying, that's our God. She's saying, oh, God created that, too.
That's us,
you know,
too.
Like,
we're like
we're
us.
All beings that are made by the creator.
It's kind of hard to argue with positivity at this level, right? Too. You know what I mean? Like, she's literally just saying, like, oh, those lights? Yes, that's love. And then, like, she's like, that's our spirit. That's like our internal energy, spirit, like light energy or whatever she's called.
It really is uplifting.
It's very positive. So it's hard to, like, to try to poke holes in something that's so positive, you know?
And also, she could say these things are anything, though, because she actually has physical proof. She has these images. She can see this is Bigfoot's all zapping around. But I guess so, if they told her, because she's showing it to me. She has the physical prints, these blow-ups of, like, just... lights, explosions, trapper keepers.
Well, her connection to them too is, I feel like, is really interesting. That's something that I feel like we come back to on our show a lot, is these people who seem to, like, these individuals who have these experiences all the time. It's almost like, I don't want to say it's like a star seed sort of thing, but it does kind of remind me of that, where, like, feels like some people are chosen to be able to witness these things and to have this, the ability to have these sort of experiences. People like Christo, people like Dorothy, and, you know, maybe even Stephen Greer, or some people that do, you know, the CE5 stuff. So maybe there's
something
to it.
And they need others. It seems like they're never given the complete package, though, like we mentioned. Like, maybe there's someone out there, maybe Unsolved Mysteries could have found the other person who could decipher what the message is. They tried. Yeah,
maybe. I mean, she starts to, like, semi, like, understand what they're saying to her in some ways.
She does. She does tell us the reason that the light beings are appearing to her on these cameras.
The reason they've appeared here is because they aren't worried. Because they said mankind are getting very disruptive. They're worried about us because we all belong to the whole. And we are all connected that way to each other. And if we don't behave properly, we disrupt other beings, other places. It'll cause terrific damage because we're either spill into their world or they'll spill into ours. It disrupts other beings from different places. It'll cause imbalance between us and them. They live now where everyone is equal. They'll train each other. So they're all aware, have the same knowledge, and understand each other very well. So that's why they had to come and wake us up and say, look, you're not the only ones here in this universe. And someone's got to film it to prove that this light exists, because we are all connected to each other.
They might need to hurry this process up, maybe, like, let a little more of us in, because I feel like the world's getting way more divided. And
seriously,
these guys, they have it figured out, this whole living together in harmony thing. Like, we need a little more.
This is like the cosmic version of, like, us, sir, we're going to have to ask you to leave if you cannot control yourself. Like, you're bothering the other people.
I hate to keep...
You
want to
bring up Loki. You do want
That, I do want to bring up Loki. It did very much remind me of Loki again, but also reminded me, strangely enough, of Stephen Greer again, of how it's like, his whole thing is like, we need to get this insane amount of people together on the same level in order to achieve this connection with the ETs, which is kind of... you know, roundabout what she's sort of saying too. It's just an interesting parallel between those two things. But there is also a huge Loki parallel there as well, where you do, like, I don't know. It's strange how much these things relate to each other. Yeah, I don't want to give any spoilers away. I'm trying to say as much as I can without saying anything at the same time. So I'm sorry.
It's just interesting, yeah, that she does bring up the idea of they're being upset that, you know, dimensions could be spilling into each other, you know, based on events that happen here. And even though Dorothy has filmed these lights for decades, her family was always skeptical because they never saw the lights firsthand until this happened to Dorothy's daughter, Marilyn.
This was 2002 when this happened. So I was doing stuff here, washing or whatever, and Mom said, they're here. And I thought, oh, really? and I leaned out to look out the window here. So I sort of thought about it for a minute. She went upstairs, got her camera, came back down. And then I said to her, I'm coming out with you, okay?
So I said, oh yeah, good idea. We got on a deck.
There was nothing you could see. There was not a star, not a light, nothing. So I thought, okay, this should be interesting.
And then she said, we saw one light came, two, three.
And then all of a sudden, three lights, like round balls, two littler ones, one big one, came in. And it just sort of pulsated a bit. Mom put her camera down. She says, okay, I've got enough. It's getting kind of cold out here. I'm going in. And in she went. I'm standing on that deck thinking, okay, did I really see this? I mean, my hair is up on my arm, and I'm thinking, okay, I wasn't hallucinating. I didn't have any wine with dinner. What's going on? And, I mean, you have to believe when you see that. What do you do?
Yeah, now her daughter has finally seen them as well. But the most interesting part of that interview that we heard with Marilyn is that while she is saying this, she is standing in front of their kitchen window, and there are lights floating around in the sky behind her and is picked up in the documentary. I was really blown away by this. Mm-hmm. What did you think of this part of capturing the light, Treya?
It was just like, it was that moment where I got chills and everything. Cause yeah, I've seen videos of things that looked really compelling and then come to find out that they were fake. Like, a man called Host, that guy, like who Turner Clay. Yeah. And then so I get so bummed out because I'm like, dang, man, that actually looked really real. I had that moment of like chills. But this, I mean, you know, as we've been going over and over again, it's not debunkable. It's definitely like I got excited, but like creeped out at the same time.
And you don't notice it because you're just watching her. You're listening to her. You're listening to her. I don't know why, but play Soundboard 7.
Round balls, two littler ones, one big one.
I knew it. I knew it was coming. I knew that was coming. I had a feeling you're going to do that.
No, but you're watching this. You listen to her. You listen to her talk about the round balls is one, two, three.
Round balls, two littler ones, one big one.
So, but while she's talking about this, there's all this photo bomb stuff going on.
It's literally, it reminded me of like when Tom Hanks photobombs people, like, you know, like
it just like peeks up from behind her hair.
Yeah,
like
it's like when celebrities photobomb people. It was literally, it reminded me of that, except it was like on a fucking intergalactic level.
And the filmmakers, they don't even realize that they've captured these lights on the tape. And when they do, they send the footage to ILM, to Industrial Light and Magic. They want to see if this footage is altered in any way, and it isn't. It's not a reflection in the window either, because if one window is open and one is closed, and it passes over both of these windows behind her, and the image, whatever this is flying around, the image stays the same. So they reveal the footage to the entire family, because they've never seen it, and they are all shocked. Marilyn's husband, the one that was talking about the three light balls, her husband, he gets real upset. He drives out of that to the area where the lights would come from, and he tries to replicate it but can't. It's really incredible.
Yeah, they do like a YouTube reaction to the footage that they filmed. It reminded
me
very
much. It's a VHS tape. Yeah, they put in a VHS tape, and we get to watch them react. I was like, this was 2008, I guess, you know.
Very, very early reaction footage is before it even became a thing. But watching their reactions to it was great because they were all kind of were a little different. Dorothy was just sitting there with her, of course, she got her big smile on her face, just loving it. Like,
she's like, finally, she knows it's her moment of redemption.
She was just loving it. Like, just like I told you. I fucking told you.
I think this might be, besides the one on Unsolved Mysteries, this might be the first time where she's not holding a camera. A different camera is capturing the lights while her daughter is talking about it. And there's something even more incredible on it. Dorothy's granddaughter, when they're doing their little reaction video, the granddaughter notices that not only are there lights in the window, there are also smaller orbs of light in the room with her mom, Marilyn.
Orbs.
Yeah.
We're getting into orbs again, guys.
Let's hear from her.
During the first few seconds of my mom's interview, I can see two separate balls of light. One comes in from either the left or right, and it looks like it goes kind of slow across her, and it almost like enters her body through around her throat level, and then another one quickly goes the opposite way diagonally across from her, and it just looks like a round sphere, and you can kind of see through it. It's like translucent. It's not super bright. I don't know. I was a little kind of taken back because my grandmother has spoken of them in her apartment before, and that other people have seen them. He told me probably on a good 5 or 6 different occasions. And there's actually been friends of hers that have observed them as well.
These look more like the classic orb. So while you're seeing lights in the sky, you're seeing almost like the ones that are kind of hard to classify, Drea. Are they dust? Are they camera anomalies? These are kind of the ghostly orbs. But it's still really cool because the orb flies into Marilyn and it looks like she reacts physically to it. Yeah. Like she kind of perks up. She blinks and kind of picks her head up.
Her face reacts to it as it hits her throat area. Which reminded me of stuff I've seen on Ghost Adventures, too, of, like, orb footage, where, like, it'll fly into certain particular areas, like the middle of the chest or throat area, the back of the, like, top of your spine, like, where your neck and your head meets your neck right there. It'll fly, like, right to the center spot. It's really strange. And the same thing where, like, when it happens on that show, when it hits their body, they physically react in the same sort of a way where, like, it's almost like they take a deep breath or like they get kind of pushed back a little bit, you know,
or like that sensation where, like, you know, every now and then you'll just get a nerve sensation, like something will either itch or kind of like hurt for a second. Just kind of like, what the hell was that?
Yeah, you kind of flinch. Usually what you looks get like a weird flinch, sort of.
And I have to wonder, how many times have you experienced something like that? You know, it could be just driving or at work, and all of a sudden, something just kind of, like, feels weird.
Yeah.
Out of nowhere.
It could have been an orb. And I mean, what are the odds that Dorothy lives in a haunted house? It makes me think that all orbs are maybe more alien light being associated.
It definitely opened up a lot of, like, questions and possibilities in my mind as far as that goes. Like, it was very, like, bewildering when I saw that there were orb things happening, too. Because, you know, my stance on orbs, at least in photographs, a lot of times I'm like, you know, yeah, there's so many other things it could be. But when you look at the timing and the connection of something like that, it just does make me think that those kinds of things, if they're not insects or dust or whatever, that they're maybe not a ghost, but just some form of energy.
Yeah, to me, I'm looking at it as, like, it's almost like a microcosm of the whole experience that she's having, like, where these light things, these balls are coming from who knows where, and they're coming here. What are they doing here? Like, the idea is that maybe they're, like, I think of, like, Earth as being like a gas station in a way, or certain areas of our planet are like a gas station for them where they can go and fuel up on energy. And yes, like, this is just like a smaller version of that, where it's like there's the actual beings are with us now in our house, fueling up on us, like stopping at certain parts of our body to take energy.
Whoa. I don't appreciate that. Yeah. Like
that's
mosquitoes.
Kind of what I just looking at it from a complete outsider's perspective. Maybe this is just a crackpot theory that I've just
created
in my mind, but I just see, like, people always say, like, they see UFOs around certain landmarks, like, you know, mountains and those kind of things. And there's certain geodes and like rocks and stuff inside those mountains that they could be possibly drawing energy from. And we have energy, life energy within us. So if these things are light beings that are able to enter our house, and like we see them doing these same sort of moves on people in different shows, different documentaries, that maybe they're doing a similar thing. Like, we are the mountains, just in a smaller scale.
Maybe the ones in the sky are trying to distract you. Like, oh no, look at those. Don't worry about us flying around inside your house, looking through stuff.
I think those are the pilots. Like they get here and then they leave their little ship, and then they come and they get a closer look to hang out with Dorothy.
Yeah. So, I mean, like, I like that theory. It makes sense. You know, there's just certain hot spots and certain people can act like beacons or whatnot. I think what the main thing might be, though, is like, I don't think that all of them are necessarily going to feed on us by, like, taking, and this is, okay, my own crackpot theory, my own. I think that something negative, a negative energy will take from you, whereas a positive one might be trying to give
you a message or just, like, connect with you. You know, like, maybe they're not giving or taking anything. It's just more of like a connection,
frolicking.
You know, like, it's giving a quick little frolic through your mind or through your soul.
I love it.
Yeah, sounds good. And right before this show concludes, they drop another mind-blowing revelation concerning Dorothy's light being still frames or blow-ups.
Mrs. Izatt noticed that one of the still photographs that she had seemed to come alive. So she got out her camera, aimed it at the photograph, and just took some footage of the still picture. When the film was developed and returned, she discovered that the image on the still photograph flashed and produced light phenomena of its own. What they told her was that the light by any medium never lost its potency, but the effect of this light on those who view it will correspond to the individual's willingness to experience it. If a person is afraid, then chances are nothing will happen. Those who are watching the images now should look carefully at what they're seeing, because whether you feel it or not, you are being touched by this very high divine light. And it will trigger something in you, in the observer, whether you notice it now or not, so that somewhere in the future, you're going to have a little more understanding of what you are experiencing.
They show a lot of these images. And I got to say, did it stir anything in you, Drea, looking at these?
Oh, so many things. It really did. And it wasn't just because I was also being a high divine being. Like, I was just like,
I was trying to. He was encouraging to. He's like, you know, if you go in there really positive and look at this, it's going to change your life. I'm like, all right, I want to see. And it's shocking that they can take her still images, her blow-ups, and film the still image of the light, and it's moving around in her, that the potency of the power of this light, it's the same in any medium.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense to me. I still am trying
to
wrap
my
mind around what they're even talking about there, how she's taking a picture of a still frame image, and they're saying that it like gives off light, the image itself or something.
We're going to post a bunch of these, so just stare at them, and we want to know how they make you feel looking at them. They do.
Oh, I misunderstood then what they were trying to say. I thought that they were just saying, like, the fact that there's, you know, the proof of it is going to be enough to stir you. I didn't.
No.
Okay.
No, no.
Now, yeah, that does sound kind of. That sounds kind of kooky.
They start talking straight to the viewer for a moment. It was like jarring for me because I was kind of like, I was casually paying attention, but then when he was like, "Look at that!" Like I was like, "Oh shit!"
I was
like,
in. I started like, "Show more."
Look at this. Felt like it was my soul was looking into this television screen, and it was making this strange connection with these pictures. And I was just like, "Am I feeling something right now? What is
this?
Did
I see my name written in there? Like, what's going on? You start seeing things. It's great."
Like, you guys didn't have that dissociation into existential dread for a second. Just me?
Oh, and that's always present, but yeah, you know, okay. You trust.
It's like when someone tells you you're gonna feel weird right now, and like you like just right. Start to feel weird right now. You know
I do
I mean?
Feel
like,
weird
I,
right now.
I think I feel kind of weird right now.
Start on focusing your eyes. You're gonna see some crazy pictures. Like,
I'm feeling weird.
Yeah, see, it works.
Great documentary, but capturing the light, it closes with some wise words from everyone's favorite UFO grandma, Dorothy Izatt.
We all have this light in us, given by the Creator. It's just that we have to learn how to use it.
When the person is sincere and really wants to see the light, they'll see it. You don't have to be a saint. If you really want to see them for a purpose, they'll show up and help you. But you've got to be honest and true with it.
Thousands now that's gone through my home. I branched off and did some of their own from there. Little gatherings together.
Whoa, look at that.
You.
Look at that thing. Oh, it doubled. It split into two.
Ooh.
Whoa. It doubled. Whoa. Whoa. Check it out. That was awesome.
It's up to each person to think about it. And it won't hurt me if they think I'm a loony and say that, you know, these things don't exist. Fine. You know, they have to find out from themselves, right? But what I'm experiencing is I'm sharing it. Take it or leave it.
Dorothy Izatt is the best witness, the best claimant anyone could hope for. The importance in this subject is really inherent in the very fact that it exists.
That's true and very deep. And I like that in the closing of this, I didn't really cut that. Like, we also got some of those great UFO reaction people. You remember the CE5 guys a few weeks ago?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
remember what they were talking about? They were seeing four. Play Soundboard 8. This reminded me of those guys, the four guys.
It doubled. It split into two.
Woo.
It doubled.
Woo.
Yeah, all right. They were borderline reminding me of the classic clip.
That baby went in warp drive.
Oh, yeah. Gold
that was
breeze.
Exactly what I thought of. Yeah.
And, this was a good reaction. We had to keep this on the board. Play Soundboard 9.
Check it out. That was awesome.
All right. Thank you, guys.
I had a feeling you'd like that one.
And that's how it closed. And I'm going to close with this. Dorothy Wilkinson Izatt. She continued filming and experiencing the light beings in the years that followed this documentary. But sadly, on January 29th of this year, she passed away at age 99.
Aww. Oh, I didn't know.
Leaving behind a wonderful family and a long and compelling legacy of fascinating UFO and alien footage. Drea, do you have any final thoughts on alien contactee Dorothy Izatt?
Yes, I love her, and I wish she was my grandma, and rest in peace. That's so sad.
Yeah, 99 years old she made it. And
what a great you know, life and experience, though, that, I don't know, I just, that... this whole thing was so compelling. Like, I really enjoyed it.
And the hours and hours of footage that can be interpreted forever, that anyone could see anytime. Well, what about you, Rob? Any final thoughts on Miss Dorothy?
I just, like I said, you know, like I said earlier, I think that there is something to these sorts of people, these people who seem to be chosen to have these experiences. And I don't think that it's something that we are ever really going to completely understand, but I think that there's definitely something to it. And Dorothy seemed like a very pure witness. She didn't seem like she was really out to achieve anything. She was just sharing her experiences. And like they said at the end, you know, it's all about your mindset and like the energy that you bring to it. Where like, if you bring bad energy to an experience like that, you're not going to have any experience. Like, just like Unsolved Mysteries, like something there was something the aliens didn't like their vibe. So I think it's very interesting. So yeah, check out that documentary. It's actually really good.
It's real short too. It's only about 45 minutes while Capturing the Light. You can find it on streaming services.
The perfect length for a documentary like this.
Lots of, and you could get really sucked in at the end when they start showing you those still images and start making you start thinking about your existence and being a light being and all that great stuff. So be sure and answer this week's poll. What is going on in the films of Dorothy Izatt? Are they aliens? Is it camera tricks? Is it the devil? Or, of course, other. So just go to unbelieverspodcast.com to vote. And great job, you two. Another successful show. More mystery lights. Follow me home.
I love them.
I gotta say, I'm very happy that we did this episode. I need a little positivity in our little unbeliever world right now. I feel like, I know we mentioned last week, but we're starting to get deep into the tournament of SOS on Patreon and talking about all the shittiest aspects of the paranormal so much. I need a little palate cleanser. So I'm thankful that Dorothy was there for this.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, she's just so like, her story's so wholesome, and there's no, like, weird angles. There's not even any creepy angles. This is just a really, not that we needed just, like, a feel-good episode, but it was. Like, it feels good.
Well, it's just funny that our show, we go from doing something like this one week.
It's almost like it sucks.
Something. To something wholesome and, that we actually do. We support Dorothy, you know what I mean? So it's funny. From week to week, things really do change on the show.
Need a little balance. And because the tournament of SOS, if you want to go have fun with that, join us on Patreon. We're getting close. The seeding is getting close. We've got all the players being, a lot of surprises happening too. Some play-in players are starting to surprise
people. I'm getting pretty excited. At first I was like, oh God, we're going to do something really bad here. But no, now I'm excited.
No, it's getting fun. The first four seeds are all set. So we're gearing it up. There's still a lot of time though.
Yeah, that's going to be really good. Once we start to get into it. I'm really excited to see where that goes.
I'm still a little worried about like what's going to ensue, and like there's going to be consequences to this, I feel.
I think it's a good thing that it's only on Patreon. That's all I'm going to say. It's a good thing that you can only hear that on Patreon because I don't know. It's just going to get,
does that mean it's not canon?
A little weird, I think.
If it's only on Patreon, is it not? It doesn't fit into the canon, or
that's its own little multiverse over
there.
It's
own little
it is.
Thing.
Oh, phew.
But we got another segment to do. Let's get into the Unbelievers mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo! Woo! Woo!
And this week, this week is a traditional Unbelievers mailbag. I'm going to read some mail. We got some good voicemails. We're going to save that for next week, but I've got some actual mail from the email I want to get into. And our first one from this evening comes from Jason Weaver, who writes, "We all know Art is obsessed with three things: ham radio, the weather, and rods." In the archive, 5/16/97, at approximately an hour 22 minutes, Art Bell misspeaks and says, "Drop it like a hot rod, I mean rock." My man definitely has rods on the brain, Jason Weaver. Well, thank you, Jason Weaver, for giving me a heads up about the Art Bell archive that there are some rod references going missed. And so I went and clipped it because thank you for giving me the timestamps and the date, everything.
Oh, wow.
You made it so easy for me. I'm going to give this a little backstory. We're going to hear the clip. There is a caller who has a question about something called the Hanford nuclear explosion. So let's hear from her west of the Rockies.
Also, I wanted to ask a question about the Hanford story, about an explosion or something that happened at the Hanford nuclear plant.
There were eight, indeed, there was an explosion heard 30 miles away that did not, they're still saying, involve the release of any nuclear materials, but did flood, and eight were taken to the hospital, apparently unhurt. Keyword, apparently. So that's all we know right now.
Well, the thing is, after it was announced, I heard it on a newscast on, I looked for it the next day in newspapers, and I also, by the way, don't have a TV, so.
Well, they don't like to advertise that kind of thing. I mean, it gets on the news, and then as soon as they're able to, they drop it like a hot rod. I mean, rock.
Nothing at all about it at all, but, nice. But Miss Universe, you know.
Oh, what a beauty is she. What a beauty, Miss USA.
Sure she is, but, you know, we could use some updates on Hanford, too, huh?
I gotta go.
You're listening to Art Bell, Somewhere in Time.
No, thank you so much, Jason Weaver. I love that clip. Wait, we got to have the soundboard of it.
Drop it like a hot rod.
I love that. And I know, you know, what a hot rod is, but like, I just can't not picture Andy Samberg hot rod.
Oh my God.
Yo, well, play the next clip I have, because I thought more of Snoop Dogg.
Yeah.
Pimps in the crib, ma. Drop it like a hot rod. 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 Drop it like a hot rod.
Oh, yeah,
all right, if you could do better, send it, but that's all I, that's my limited.
Oh my God, that was fantastic. That was DJ Ross right there?
It was.
Yeah, it was a little rough. That was a little Russ Rod, Hot Rod remix there.
Russ Rod?
Like a hot rod.
I was literally going to ask. I was going to ask someone to do "Drop It Like a Rod," "Drop It Like a Rod,"
"Oh
drop
yeah,
it like a rod." Because I feel like it's like I don't know. We have very creative musical listeners, so I could see someone pulling that off very nicely. But
I want to hear it.
You did
we
a
need
great
to hear
job, though, Russ. That was fantastic, dude. Good job.
I tried it. Hey, that's featuring Jason Weaver for giving the heads up on that. So thank you so much, Jason Weaver.
Produced by Jason Weaver, co-produced.
Yeah.
And man, since we're doing just such a positivity love fest tonight, I got a really nice email. This comes from Unbeliever Darcy. It says, "Hey guys, I would like to start off by saying I love the show. I was looking for a podcast to listen to about the Ariel School UFO encounter. Mm. And after listening to every one they had on Spotify, I found myself coming back to listen to more of the Unbelievers podcast. Full disclosure, please. I had never heard of the Unbelievable podcast, and I just started listening to the Unbelievers podcast like last week, but I've been pretty much listening every chance I get. This morning, I start episode 42, Puck Wudgy. I left a 5-star review on Facebook, but I don't have an account with Apple, but I am following you on Spotify. Thank you so much. Anyways, I just want to say I really enjoy the show. Can't wait to get all caught up and answer some of these poll results.
Yes,
and obviously,
please.
Go back and binge the shit out of the Unbelievable podcast. Keep up the great work. Love the show. Love you guys. Your new pal, Unbeliever Darcy.
Oh, my God.
Thank
I love you,
Unbeliever Darcy.
That's
think
so
about
nice.
It. She's looking, just trying to find more podcasts about the Ariel School, comes across our old episode, and she's almost to Puck Wedgies. Maybe she's a little further yeah. at the time of this reading.
That yeah. was a really fun episode, too. The
that
Ariel
was.
School episode. That was really an interesting situation, which I think I friended one of the kids who saw the phenomenon.
Did you?
And like we had talked about maybe bringing them on the show and like interviewing them about it. So maybe we'll bring that idea
I think
back.
Yeah, we got to circle around back to that sometime.
Because I still am friends with her on Instagram, so I just need to reach out and we could probably make it happen. So
yeah, I would love to do an interview.
You guys are interested
let's do that.
Oh, yeah, to talk about someone that experienced the Ariel School
yeah, she was
encounter.
There.
That'd be great. Love to do that. All right. And yeah, so like I said, we're going to play some voicemails next week. But thank you so much for that. I don't know. Play that soundboard clip again, though, what we got from Jason Weaver. It's too much. We got all. I love it.
Pimps in the crib, ma. Drop it like a hot rod. Drop it like a hot rod. Drop it like a hot rod.
All right, I just
finished. Drop it like a hot rod. Drop it like a hot rod. Drop it like a hot rod. Get an
attitude. Fantastic, dude. All right. Yes, and that's it for this week's Unbelievers voice mailbag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbag.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. 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 The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo!
Man, and we had a rod sound clip in the main part in the mailbag. Man, if we can get it in the next part, we'll hit the trifecta. Someone might win because what's up next, Drea?
Poll results.
This week's poll: do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? And the choices were yes, no, or other. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, what do you think the Unbelievers said?
Yes.
All right. How about you, Rob?
No.
And you can't vote other. Yeah.
Well, congratulations, Drea, with a whopping 14.29% of the vote. Yes,
all right.
The Unbelievers believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens, but of course, there are others. Why would I lie about getting superpowers from two wieners in the woods? I have the evidence. There's DNA on the walls, or trees. Signed, The Machinist. Superpower from two wieners? To what's in the woods?
Jim and Jack Wiener.
Two wieners,
those are the
actually.
Two. Those are the two.
For the present right. One.
Yeah, he says he has the evidence because...
I say let's shoot the hell out of it and collect the DNA off the walls.
He says, Earth trees. Thank you, Machinist. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? Not sure, but don't tell Scotty, because Scotty doesn't know. Signed, Anaconda Vice. All right, thank you, Anaconda Vice.
I like
love
that
it.
One.
Scotty doesn't know. We don't know. I don't know. No one knows. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? I believe they didn't rebuild the fire. Signed, Pants Filler. I'm pretty sure they didn't, too, because they even said it. I mean.
Let's just go to bed. We don't want to rebuild the fire.
They didn't. Thank you. Thanks so much to the guy.
Be throwing up and filling my pants.
Thank you, Pants Filler. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? Don't stop believing. Hold on to that feeling, streetlight people. Sign Journeyman. Journeyman. Okay. Thank you, Journeyman.
Okay. I'm feeling it.
Awesome.
I like you, Journeyman. Welcome, Journeyman. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? No. The cows that were about to cow versus bull inspection ratio wasn't right. Signed. Left-handed buckle grabber. What was this cow's doing?
Went out to check the cows. We had some cows that were about to calf.
Well, there's some kind of ratio against this guy?
I want to check the bulls and pans for myself.
That's the bull inspection. Okay. Thank you to the guy who...
I remember gripping my belt buckle with my left hand, I think it was.
Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? Jack Wiener was, just like my Jack Lynx were abducted by Sasquatch.
Mm.
Cool. Signed, Hose B. They're a little cool in there.
Cool.
Well, he thinks Jack Wiener was.
Jim and Jack Wiener.
No, he just said Jack Wiener. Yeah, because his Jack Lynx were abducted by Sasquatch.
Cool.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Joe's B. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? I haven't listened to this episode yet, but let me tell you something. Signed, Diddy Kong. All right, well, that was certainly something. Thank you, Diddy Kong. We're signing off, too.
Tell us something.
Diddy Kong.
Thank you, Diddy Kong. Do you believe the Allagash Four were abducted by aliens? They were abducted by some Martian or shit or something. And now, these four men can't stop occasionally ingesting leaves. Signed, Lid Vicious. Thank you, Lid Vicious. They're abducted by who?
We saw some Martian or shit or something.
Okay, and now there's four naked guys, and they can't. Were they eat?
What's the last thing you ate?
A leaf.
Thank you, Liz. I feel like that's been coming up a lot more lately. Thank you for that. Yes, I think we were speaking about, weren't we talking about Jonathan Trinity Yael recently?
Yeah, for the seating or for the SOS.
He was possibly going to make it into the sack of shit tournament.
He didn't get in there. Not even close.
No, he's an alien, pure. So he belongs in the tournament of aliens. So technically, you know, it's not even really his thing. It's not his class.
You're right. And thanks, Lewd Vicious. Do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? Their story seems credible to me. Pardon me while I squeeze off a message. The signed Blue Box UFO. Oh my god. I can't believe he actually fit this in here, but he said their story seems credible. Credible to him. We might have to put those two together for him.
You know what's funny, too? There's another clip from the Unbelievable podcast called, let's see what that is.
What the hell?
And I believe that?
That
wasn't a supercut. That just was
that's
organic.
Just, that's just one guy just
just fucking up.
Organically,
that sounds
yes.
like Max Spears, which makes it even
darker.
It says
Brenton Sawin. Brenton
okay.
Sawin. So
someone get to the bottom of that. Brenton Sawin going, thank you, Blue Box UFO. Do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? It hurts so weird. Come on, baby, make it hurt so weird. Signed, Rococo style. Okay. Hurt
Love
so
it.
Weird. Come on, baby, make it. Or thank you to...
Well, I mean, honestly, if it hurts so weird, I feel like we need to play a weird clip, don't we?
Investigator Nick Weird.
Nice to meet you. I'm Nick Weird.
Nick
nice,
Weird?
Nice.
It hurts so weird. Weird.
hurts so Nick Weird. Yes, thank you so much to...
Of the Rococo style that embellished the building.
Oh, not the non-aggressive one this week, the non-winner.
We gotta switch it up every once in a while.
Yeah, we gotta switch up a little bit. Thank you, Rococo style. Do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? They look like a darn mantis, of course. They had to fill the bowls themselves. The aliens wanted to watch. Signed, the Wombat Preservationist. Okay, maybe so.
It looked like a darn mantis.
Aliens did? Aliens?
It's getting back to Huggins because, of course, they had to.
We went to this room. There was this bowl on this table, and I was supposed to ejaculate into the bowl.
Great. Thank you, Wombat Preservationist. Do you think the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? Doe. Signed, Singing Cactus. Keep it simple. Thank you, Singing Cactus. Aww. And he always says. Thank you, Singing Cactus. Or speaking Japanese cactus. That wasn't much of a song. Do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? This is weird. Wieners, racks, sucking. Those are three things my wife shouts in her sleep. Signed, K. Mill.
Oh, no.
I had a feeling that's who it was, to be honest.
It's almost like it sucks something.
We didn't even mention much. Yeah, that guy's name was Chuck Rax. We got the Rax, the Wieners, the Sucking. K. Mill, he's not going to miss any of those.
That's why we have him for, to point out the naughty things that we missed the first time. You know?
It's true. And yeah, go listen to I Don't Know podcast. Great show. Do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? SOS is commonly known as suck off sausages in the alien handbook. So you really can't blame the aliens. Signed, Harley Warren. Boy, that one really makes you think.
It's true.
That would SOS is what are they doing?
It's almost like it sucks something.
Oh.
Sucks sausage. Yeah.
Sausage?
Well, sucks or something is SOS too. But we could be sure. You want to be sausage?
Oh my god, you're right.
Thank you, Harley Warren. And finally, do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? The late 70s was about the same time my dad was hiding in his cave. So he probably took them there to his cave, you know? Signed, Scared of My Dad Guy. Scared of My Dad Guy back again. Thank you so much. I've been loving your presence now. So I'm going to go over them. That was the final one. I'll go over the ones for this evening. We had for the question, do you believe the Allagash 4 were abducted by aliens? We had the Machinist with, why would I lie about getting superpower from two wieners in the woods? I have the evidence. There's DNA on the walls or trees. We had Anaconda Vice with, not sure, but don't tell Scotty because Scotty doesn't know. We had Pants Filler with, I believe they didn't rebuild the fire. I really like that one. We had Journeyman with, don't stop believing, hold on to that feeling, streetlight people. We had the Left-Handed Buckle Grabber with, no, the cows that were about to cow versus bull inspection ratio wasn't right. We had, oh, wait, no, this one didn't sign off. Just said LSD, question mark. I kind of missed that earlier. You didn't sign off.
I mean, that's a good guess. Good guy.
We had Hose B with Jack Wiener was just like my Jack Lynx were abducted by Sasquatch. Cool. We had Diddy Kong with, I haven't listened to this episode yet, but let me tell you something. We had Lid Vicious with, they were abducted by some Martian or shit or something, and now these four men can't stop occasionally ingesting leaves. You had Blue Box UFO with, their story sees credible to me. Pardon me while I squeeze off a message. This one didn't sign off. We had Rococo Style with, it hurts so weird. Come on, baby, make it hurt so weird. We had the Wombat Preservationist with, they look like a darn mantis. Of course, they had to fill the bowls themselves. The aliens wanted to watch. We had the Singing Cactus with, do-do. We had K-Mill with, this is weird. Wieners, racks, sucking. Those are three things my wife shouts in her sleep. We had Harley Warren with, SOS is commonly known as suck-off sausages in the Alien Handbook, so you can't really blame the aliens. And finally, Scared of My Dad guy with, the late 70s was about the same time my dad was hiding in his cave, so he probably took them to his cave, you know? Thank you. So many great ones, as always, but I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, who do you think won this week's poll?
Holy shit, you guys, make it so difficult. Like, Rococo Styles was so, so good, but I mean, like, and I think it was the very first one. Why would I lie about getting superpowers from two wieners in the woods?
Yeah, I like
that's
that
a real
a
good
lot.
One. The Mac.
I mean, because once again, because it answers the question kind of, and it was, I mean, just hilarious. I gotta give it to that one.
All right, Drea goes with the Machinist. What about you, Rob?
I agree with her. I agree with her on that one. I really did like that one too. I thought that was very well put together.
All right.
Hilarious, you guys.
Yeah, I gotta agree too. It was really funny. I'll give some honorable mention to Pants Filler with, I believe they didn't rebuild the fire. A little straightforward, but congratulations to the Machinist with, why would I lie about getting superpowers from two wieners in the woods? I have the evidence. There's DNA on the walls or trees. You just won this week's poll results. All right, we've come to the end of the program, but before we go, Drea Mora, do you have anything you would like to say or plug?
SpiritsandSpiritsPod.com and Spirits and Spirits Pod on Instagram. Our Patreon is getting more merch stuff soon. Keychains.
Excellent. And what about you, Rob Oakey?
I want to plug our Discord this week because I always forget that we have one. So if you like Discord, in the description of this episode, click the link, join the Discord. There's always people talking about crazy stuff in there. That's a lot of fun. And I want to say thank you to all of our patrons. We have over 50 patrons now, which is an amazing accomplishment. I feel like when we started this, we couldn't have imagined having 50 patrons. And the fact that you guys are supporting us is so fucking cool. You guys are the best.
Yeah, it is. Really is great. I'm just going to plug the Mothman Festival. Ooh. It's in 2 months, and we will be there.
Oh, yeah.
We will meet you if you want to hang out at Mothman Fest. The Unbelievers Podcast will be there. The Unbelievers Podcast host today were Drea Mora and me, Russ Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Oakey. You can get our tarot cards at unbelievablepodcards.com. You can go join our Patreon that Rob was talking about by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. Follow us on Twitter at Unbelievers Pod and Instagram at Unbelievers Podcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. And check out our merch store at TeePublic. There's a link in the description. And thank you so much to all the supporters of Patreon. Linnea, Sturte, Fabian, Art Muffin, Nick Marshall, Ramiro, Sam Schwoval, Creepy Little Book, Johnny Knott, Sanda and Deborah Foles, Cade Baute, Chris Stroker, Jeffrey Hartramph, Luis Payon, 8-Bit Melody, Jenny Dyer, Christopher Balderama, David Echohaw, Pam Z, JT Spranklin, Vic Voss, Little BB, Dr. Ortega, Tyler Ventura, Adam Dvorak, Cryptid Mask, Michael Field, Carol Valley, Manny, MQ Ultra, CJP, Braden Hit, Raymond Royal, Todd X, Christopher Panici, The Moon, The Judgy Moon, Mike Henry, Bryce Cronenberg Jr., Don Bright, Shannon Frigno, Tom O'Connell, Donna Mann, Jenna Stevens, Cat Chaos, Jason Kelly, and Mike of the Mike Army, Brian Ashen, Michael Armenta, Jack S., Wombat Preservationist. Our music advisor is Pandora 3373. Our official composer and theme song creator is Unbeliever A.A. Ron, a.k.a. Aaron Schilb. You can follow him on Instagram at TheAaronSchilb. Our official graphic designer at Cardmaker, who designed our logo, is Raymond Rowell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and Project Raven Creative on Instagram. Our visual Unbeliever listening between the stations for a message from Art Bell is Scott E. Oh, I guess you missed that one about the rod, Scott E., but we got it picked up. Our official Hazmat Lou is Hazmat Lou. Our official Unbeliever without a title is Nicholas Darastavi. Our official Unbeliever raising Puck Wudgies is Joe Filler. Our official Wisconsin, Michigan Dogman paranormal investigator is Green Finhawk. Our official resident Sagittarius is Kozanton. Our official Madman is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Mothman enthusiast is Michael Shields. I am a Mothman enthusiast. Will be at Mothman Fest. He has confirmed. Our official Unbeliever is Move On Inside Man is Chris DeMoraes. Our official Unbeliever peacefully eating a hamburger is Michelle Durham. Our official Unbeliever's time traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official ghost hunter is Amelia Childs and Ghost Hunting in New England and Hubie Halloween on Netflix. Our official senior European correspondent is Kay Mill of the I Don't Know podcast. Our official guardian of the benches at Kraken Stacker. Our official alien bopper is Nunchuck Bop. And this week's Unbeliever focus is Lydia Sturte, who has been having some good progress with her CE5 alien signaling. She's been out there with the flashlights, maybe the app, and she asked us for some advice on making contact. I told her that she needs to keep at it, just document the evidence, and...
most of all, he said keep away from the lunatic fringe.
Good night, L-O-V-E.
For the wise.
Discontinue! Discontinue!